Well, good afternoon to all the distinguished participants of the Inclusive Manufacturing Forum and the young students who have been drawn from various universities, both as part of being sponsors of this forum. It's indeed a pleasure for my Department of Science and Technology to have chosen this as a context to seed a very important BRICS meeting on science and technology driven innovation and entrepreneurship partnership agenda. I'm very pleased to be here to represent the International Multilateral and Regional Cooperation Division interest, represented through me and two of my colleagues in this group, Dr. Rita Gupta and Dr. Arvind Kumar, who are looking into superimposing many initiatives that are residing on this subject at G20 level, at UN Agenda 2030 level. And we also have an input of various bilateral frameworks that we have had with many countries over last 25 years in the formal sense. This being the case, I just wanted to say why we chose to listen through this 3 days discussions, because today we don't want to imagine collaborations without the ground realities expressed by many experiments that we heard. When I heard the, see, I have benefited from about 57 presentations in last 2 days, and I have equally absorbed what was spoken when the narrations were around inclusive innovations. We heard also that inclusive manufacturing has different connotations. And when the narratives of small and medium enterprises, small-scale industries, entrepreneurs, rural enterprises was being talked, that was yet another narrative from the organizations who have to dwell on choosing their menu of business, whether they track inclusive innovation as their occupation or they chase inclusive manufacturing agendas for their business. The third narrative, which was very interesting, was how Tata Trust or some of the World Bank initiatives or some of the UK-driven global challenge research funds have come up in the recent times, and what new engagements entity like Tata Trust has built in institutionalizing a foundation for innovation and social entrepreneurship. There are climate innovation centers of excellence being set out by World Bank. Now, these are some of the institutional mechanisms that I could absorb. And there are some national design innovation networks and platforms in the recent times. There are reimagining waste hackathons being done in this country. So we are seeing different experiments as an updated information to look at my portfolio of attention, which is how do I build BRICS agenda for science and technology driven innovation and entrepreneurship partnership. I'm very honored to see that we have been able to have 11 participants from BRICS countries, which are our counterpart from the Department of Science and Technology, listening to the outcomes of this inclusive manufacturing platform, where the story was largely an India story, but we had few well-meaning experiential inferences from UK and also to some degree in the documents that you have generated before this forum being put in ground. I would like to now come to the purpose with which I take some useful thoughts of this meeting to my work, and I wanted to share what are we doing under BRICS as a regional entity where Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa are engaged in a strategic partnership. Today, science, technology, and innovation features very significantly in this strategic partnership. Our journey from 2015 till now has been very rapid. We have created a science, technology, innovation cooperation memorandum of understanding at the intergovernmental level. The objectives are essentially to connect our collaborations and partnerships for socially relevant, challenge-driven solutions and knowledge creation. Once such MOUs were set up in 2015, out of our experience, within a year's time, 8 research funding agencies from 5 BRICS countries have put together $10 million worth of envelope for co-investment of resources to support any collaborative partnerships. So within a span of 1 year, we first wanted to establish our willingness to co-invest resources, and to us, money is one of the element, not the be-all element. Our people, our institutions, our resources, which can never be calibrated in money value. And those are the willingness that we saw amongst 5 ministries of science and technology in these countries who have agreed to take that pace. We also, within this span, India could seed a BRICS Young Scientist Forum as an umbrella framework to tap the aspirations of young talent in science, engineering, and allied disciplines to be given some window of expression to charter their aspirations for research career pathways or their aspirations to take up their own startups or entrepreneurial exercises. And this Young Scientist Forum has given us a Young Scientist Conclave debate last year where affordable healthcare, computational intelligence, and energy solutions were talked amongst a group of 50 such young professionals who were having credible track records. That's the second layer of our visibility and stakeholder engagement to get on. Last year, India was having the chairmanship of BRICS and building responsible, inclusive, collective solutions was our focal theme of partnerships, and that partnership brought us to float a vision need for science and technology driven innovation and entrepreneurship partnerships. And that vision that we floated in our science and technology ministerial meeting last year gave us a window to explore this path and come up with a cooperation agenda and priorities and funding mechanisms and opportunities to be broadcasted in an open, accessible way. Today, out of these discussions, I have picked up a reaffirmation that our partnerships in terms of themes should be around maybe affordable healthcare innovations and solutions. We are looking at windows where medical devices, implants, diagnostics, therapeutics could be one point where the innovators and innovative solutions and entrepreneurial actions should be targeted. And recently, the interest on epidemic surveillance innovations is being talked of, which is not only important to BRICS, but to the world at large. Our preparedness to handle emergence of epidemics has to be handled differently, and this is a new element which is being added to our attention. And I thought I'll mention this because the G20 Academies of Science recently met about a fortnight ago, and they considered that our health systems have to be robust and reliant on our preparedness for epidemic surveillance and preparedness related innovations. The second area which I feel is important, when I heard your inclusive manufacturing related presentation, is what do we do where the small and maybe we call it by different names, but sometimes we call it as small and small scale industries or rural enterprises or micro and small and medium enterprises. But the bottom line is, how do we provide a different meaning of innovative inputs to the performance and outputs of such entities? And here, one theme that is very important to us is on recycle, reuse, and new use of resources that are scarce to support any kind of product development, services, and applications. We don't want to dump the society or our planet with products and services which are just multiplying our choice and lifestyle. The sustainable consumption dimension must guide us on using the resources more imaginatively. And we heard in one of the presentations that the tire of an aeroplane can be used for a desert-related transport solutions. So what are we thinking when we look at automobiles, where many components still have a long shelf life, but we abandon as a total vehicle because 15 years of the life cycle of the vehicle is gone. So these are the themes which we see as a promise to begin with, as evident from these discussions. But we are open to listen to our other colleagues from BRICS countries and shape up this menu. We would like to put out an open call for proposals on translational research, which will result into affordable, functional products, services, and applications, which add either value to the well-being of people, or which add wealth generation potential, or which would enhance the employability of our talent, because 65% of our workforce is young in this region. So the BRICS identity in terms of science, in terms of employment, in terms of well-being, in terms of sustainable development will be reflected in such an opportunity. And finally, we want to create a pan-BRICS innovation core as a talent who thinks differently, who conceives idea, and would like to give us a demonstrable proof of concept, and we would handhold them till they could come up with products of commercial value and uptake. And in that sense, our Young Scientist Forum, our innovation and entrepreneurship agenda, and our joint R&D projects that are on ground through a call encourage us to look at these three different layers to give a definition to BRICS scientific identity, talent identity, and we want to be relevant to the world at large. I think these are some of the points which I wanted to share before we go into a detailed meeting that follows tomorrow. Thank you for your attention.
Sadhana Ralia, you have been a force translated into Hindi. You have been a Shakti, and you have really been gluing this whole effort to be able to bring purpose, to bring collaborations with synergy, and also with the outcomes which are of great value. And you have given us a context in which BRICS outputs are increasing, and also the participation is increasing because the outcomes are correlated to inspire more people to join with us. May I request our friends from China and Brazil who are here to please come and occupy the chairs in the central ring. And I understand that tomorrow we'd have others joining on the video conference with respect to our proceedings on BRICS STIE, and I look forward to their participation also. Request Dr. P. Goswami to give his speech.
Good afternoon to all of you. I'm very happy that I listened to this summary session on inclusive manufacturing. And my observation has been, like, by listening to all the summaries presented by 6+1 presenters, is that these are very, very overarching issues. In fact, they apply essentially to the entire, you know, spectrum of S&T applications, manufacturing, or like Godrej says, they are a soap to software company, and I think these issues apply to soap to software, all of them. So that observation is pertinent, and I again say I'm very happy that I listened to it, because that brings us to BRICS, or BRICS STIE in particular. As you know, STIE, Sadhnaji has given a very succinct description, evolution of BRICS, and then leading us to this point where we are now talking about BRICS STIE, or science, technology, innovation, and entrepreneurship partnership. I think these are all, each one of them is a loaded word, because S&T, of course, we are familiar, but innovation, and then going to entrepreneurship, and then going to partnership, these are big leaps. Because once you talk about partnership, you need to bring in values like trust, and values like understanding, values like common aspirations, and not just simple collaboration. Now, what I found is that in one of our earlier discussions, we had always emphasized this STIE initiative, at least, must be based on strong commonalities. So that should be our guiding force. And you see, it opens up certain issues. It opens up certain issues when you try to define commonalities. It could be as simple as how to define a medium industry or a small industry, which in India could be in terms of capital investment. In Brazil, it could be something else, and other amounts. So what happens is that we need to have a very, very clear, unambiguous framework. So this will be one of our main aspirations, to create an unambiguous implementable framework where terms are precisely defined. So whether it is in, we may have to face questions like, what is affordable commonly? What is affordable in India, and what is affordable in Russia, and what is affordable in Brazil may be different. And while we might take a common minimum denomination, we must address these issues and come to consensus. So another aspirations of this meeting would be that we come to consensus. We may have differences of opinion, we may have different viewpoints, but at least they will be known and they will be recorded, and we'll try to find out ways how to address them rather than closing our eyes to them, right? So the strong commonalities, finding consensus, these are some of the aspirations that we have for the meeting that will follow tomorrow. And of course, our vision is that STIE will provide a new identity for BRICS through bold and through transformative solutions. This is easy to say, but then I think we must keep that vision in mind and then see and strive how to create a roadmap, how to devise strategies, so that we can achieve them. These words have been used before, This, we know that. But then I think today there is a new resolve. Today there is a new optimism that these words can be made into realizable solutions, realizable goals, realizable strategies. So that would be definitely our, you know, another aspiration. Of course, one might ask, what is new in this STI? International collaborations, whether within BRICS or outside BRICS, has been going on. So what is, why again another this SNT, STI has come? I think the main point there has been again come up several times in the IMF discussions, is the last mile connectivity, is closing the loop. I'm not talking about the sustainability loop, but closing the loop between SNT, the product, delivery. The delivery basically takes you to the market or maybe through some government mechanism. But unless the product, the result of the S&T collaboration or S&T R&D has reached the intended client, it has essentially failed. Whether you can you call it a value of death or whether you call it, you know, an improper, somebody talked about design, and I think all those have to be included. And that makes STI a different initiative. Because you do not stop by just having a collaborative paper, you do not stop by having a collaborative workshop, but you design a product, a product that is, has common interest, that has, you know, doability built into it, but enough S&T challenge, which BRICS together can address better. Maybe a BRICS country can address it by itself, but together we'll be able to address it better. Better means in shorter time frame, in lower cost, and in better value addition. So this will, this basically is a driving philosophy. It will evolve as we go along, but as I see, this is a driving philosophy of science, technology, and innovation entrepreneurship, which is normally missing in, you know, in conventional collaboration. And besides, in conventional collaboration, it is, you could say it is a very important component. It is a traditional component of science, curiosity-driven, in a some sense, blue sky research. You know, in it may be finding a new, you know, planetary system. It may be something else, but it is not necessarily coming from the bottom up. The bottom up is where you know that identify the needs. Somebody talked about it already. Identify the needs of the client. Identify the client. Identify their needs and wants. Even if you do only needs, if their wants are not fulfilled, the product may fail. So therefore, we do this identification of needs and wants, and then find out those where there is a strong S&T challenge and where there is a common interest. So this is how it differs from regular S&T collaborative project, which must go on. So, and of course, you know, once you go to talk about closing the loop, you must talk about the entire ecosystem. The entire ecosystem involved in science, technology, innovation, and entrepreneurship. When you talk only about S&T, your innovation system may be just the R&D infrastructure, may the, you know, the human expertise, human knowledge base, and so on and so forth. You go to the innovation, then your a new ecosystem, a component has come in which must be integrated. Once you go to entrepreneurship, another new component of ecosystem has come in, which may include items which scientists are not very comfortable with, IPR sharing, co-investment, what will be, you know, the various process of delivery mechanism, logistics. These are not items that scientists are comfortable with. But without these, it just the value of that cannot be crossed from the product to the user. I don't say market, but it must go at least from the product to the user. So one of the major agenda items, I mean, I hope you will cogitate, you will think about it. So I thought it was a very good you know, strategy on the part of the organizers to have this, you could say, you know, the pre, you know, warming up session so that we can think about them, and tomorrow we are ready with very critical comments. Because only with very, you know, very critical examination of these issues, STIE can succeed. We are talking about partnership, so therefore there can be no hesitation to come up with very strong criticism and trying to find out how or why STIE may fail. so that we can take appropriate measures to make sure it does not fail. I think I'll stop with this. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and I welcome you to National Institute of Advanced Studies, Bangalore. I welcome our friends from Brazil and China. Tomorrow is our formal meeting where we'd have the introduction. But we thought that when we are debating in India with respect to a very important aspect which touches almost all the countries, inclusive manufacturing, we sort of meet to see that these kind of forums which are today being done country-centric can be indeed made very valuable through synergy to BRICS countries. And I am very confident that these kind of forums, these kind of competence mapping, these kind of enhancing the aspirations of the countries are the hallmark of the BRICS countries, because they are the emerging countries and they have resources and the challenges, and they are very important part of the framework in the world, which the world looks with great respect and also with a possibility of collaborating with other blocs like G20 and the whole world like United Nations and others. Some of you heard about the summary session. To capture the inclusive manufacturing, which is a work which started with Rai Rajkumar at Cranfield University and NIAS, which brought in friends from ISC, ITs, and whole lot of industries and institutes and whole lot of supporters, is that for more than 1,000 years we have looked at classes of people, classes of products. Is it a right approach? Is it possible today with the advanced capabilities in design, materials, manufacturing, complete life cycle, services, to have a way that you make a product which meets the demands of every customer? And we forget about the definitions like bottom of pyramid, top 1% and all that. Our deliberations in the last 2.5 days have been indicative that indeed these products have been developed. They are being made available to the countries and to the world. But as you would have seen, there are a lot of challenges also to do the inclusive manufacturing without sacrificing the quality, the esteem of the customers, and also the affordability. We believe it would be a game changer once we realize it, and with BRICS countries it can be realized much better and expeditiously as compared to any one country trying to do this. Tomorrow we are going to do a detailed discussion on the concept note which has been circulated to the participants in the BRICS countries. We have more participation, I understand, definitely from Russia on the video conference in addition to those who are present today. But I must share with you that collaborations must have meaning. Collaborations are not tourism, collaborations are different than tourism. Collaborations should have a deep purpose and enhancement factor added to it. That enhancement factor may be 2, 5, 10, 50, depending upon the quality of the people and the quality of pursuit they wish to choose. Our experience on science and technology collaboration between BRICS countries has been remarkable, and I would repeat remarkable, because the quality of proposals, the quality of synergy which we saw among the BRICS countries, and in one proposal as many as 4 countries joining together with the best of the experts and solving an unresolvable problem as of now. And we felt very happy when we got these proposals. So building on that and taking the mandate of the BRICS ministerial meeting, it is quite natural that why we are doing science, technology, or innovation to make a better Earth planet, to serve all the citizens. So should we not think about STIE, entrepreneurship? Because that is what would create the products and the services and which would serve the society in individual country, in BRICS countries, and all the world. This was the thing which perhaps the time had not come earlier, and now only the time has come that the BRICS ministerials and the heads of the states decided in their wisdom to have the entrepreneurship, because we must now talk about the products and the services. But a question comes that who are you, a set of 20 people or 30 people drawn from 5 countries, to tell that what products and services? There are industries, there are industry chambers, there are policy makers. So what do you want to do? So we thought that yes, we could have a role, and that role would emerge much better when we discuss tomorrow, that there are certain outstanding ideas in each country which may change the society for good, which may change the definition of the healthcare, which may change the definition of the waste products. They may be at the stage of concept or a Mark I product. Can BRICS countries, with their minds, with their resources and organizations, once they choose that product, push it to a level where it matures faster, a better product, and then we have a visible change made by the BRICS countries? There's another product kind which is possible, that it creates large amount of wealth. All the BRICS countries have a great appetite for wealth generation, because they know that that alone would be enabler for them to change the quality of the life and enhance their stature of the country and the community of the nations. So we were looking at two kinds of ideas primarily, which would change the society, which would create large amount of wealth, which would also be in the framework of the science, technology, innovations, and not in the framework of patchwork to make a solutions. Agree or not, many a times these countries who are emerging economies have sometimes found solutions which are patchwork, but they are matured today to become very robust solutions. So are we looking for that kind of things also to be able to do that? I think if we can achieve with our combined wisdom, enhancing the micro and small industries in select sectors, which we can debate tomorrow, which are those sectors which we can work on, I think these are the ones which need the best minds. These are the ones which are sustaining our countries. While the big companies have the best minds available, or they can hire the best minds anywhere, micro and small, it is to me anomaly that they don't have access to the best of the minds. Can we create within us, in the BRICS countries, a framework which would provide and harness the digital platforms, the repository of innovations, open source informations, the softwares, the material packages, which would be able to change the society or the wealth generation? To me, it's cementing the BRICS. BRICS are very powerful. They would become more powerful if we are able to put cement between the BRICS. And I think making entrepreneurs to be able to deliver valuable, society-oriented, wealth-generating products and services would be a great idea. This is our first meeting starting tomorrow, so we can consider it as an ideation meeting, we can take it as an action point meeting where the action can be taken by each of the BRICS countries, and then we move forward. At NEAS, we consider it as honor to host you all. A year back, we hosted 50 young people, as Dr. Sadhana earlier mentioned, and some of my finest days in life when five countries, the brightest young minds, so enthusiastic, with the dance in their eyes and with the energy in their body, almost felt that every problem is doable, which at my age I consider it is not doable. I think in the company of those 50 people, everything looked doable, and they did generate the challenges which they are able to assess together. So this is the second time when we'd have our senior colleagues, quite natural. In India we call mixing salt and pepper, that the best results can be achieved only with the combination of young and the experienced. So I think we are making a salt and pepper combination, where we would combine the wisdom and the youth to be able to come up with new enterprises, support micro and small industries, take science, technology and innovations for the society, and set our agenda, which in the next 1, 2, 5, 10 years would transform BRICS countries. I should provide you a 2 minutes introduction to NEAS. NEAS is about 30 years old. NEAS was created by legendary industrialist J.R.D. Tata, Bharat Ratna, the highest award the government of India gives. He was very novel in his approach that you need to be amongst leaders or create leaders, and you must dialogue with the diverse viewpoints and disciplines, cultures, and through these dialogues, with the self-respect and the respect for everyone, come to certain deductions which can make a difference. So that's all our mandate. So to do that mandate, NEAS has, of course, young doctoral students pursuing their studies in multidimensional spaces which combine social sciences, humanities, science and technology, philosophy, mathematics. But we have our faculty which similarly is drawn from politicians to bureaucrats, to philosophers, to mathematicians, to social sciences, to the common citizens, to young students. So this is a very beautiful ecosystem of NEAS, where we are trying to discover the BRICS ecosystem for entrepreneurship. So I'm very happy we are here, and we are delighted to host you. Please do feel free, especially our friends from abroad, that anything which we can do to bring fun to you and purpose to your visit here, we'd be delighted to do. Thank you very much.
Going by the program that we have, I'm of the view that before we get on with the panel discussions, may we allow our participants from China and Brazil to introduce themselves so that you are part and parcel of this bigger family.
Thank you. It's been a long journey to be here, but I'm very happy to be here. I thank you all the your warm reception. Let me introduce myself. My name is Osorio Coelho. I'm from the Ministry of Science and Technology and Innovation and Communications of Brazil. I work in the Secretariat of Technological Development and Entrepreneurship. And I'm, as doctor said before, I'm going to feel free to and be very delighted if I can get out of here, go back to Brazil with a lot of cooperation between the countries. We are very eager to cooperate in our on those themes, and I'm here to listen to all your experiences, to contribute with the framework. So I just want to say on these few words that I'm very happy to be here, and I'm eager and I'm happy to contribute with all of you. Thank you very much.
Namaste, and I'm very glad to have this opportunity to be here. And I'm from a Chinese embassy and with responsibility for science and technology cooperation. And also my colleague, Mr. Shen, also from a Chinese embassy. And these two young gentlemen are experts from the consultant research institution. So just as we talk about the innovation and entrepreneurship cooperation, that is a very, very important topic because BRICS are the developing countries and also the world first economy area. And you will find that a lot of emerging industry such as information technologies and also biotechnique and also internet plus industrials or automatic intelligence. You can name a list of the industry which have been grown, has been and is going to be the key pillar industry in the national economy. So that is why, especially in the developing countries, the innovation and entrepreneurship is placed at a very high priority for the national development. So, at China, China is very eager to give to make his contributions to strengthen the cooperation in the innovation and the entrepreneurship partnership cooperations, and hope this meeting could share the inspiring discussion and foresight and get a fruitful outcome in that we promote our multilateral cooperation. So we are looking forward to that. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And since it's a panel discussion, I think all the distinguished scholars and experts are part of the panel discussion rather than just limiting to ourselves. Now, we would like to know that if BRICS was to charter a track on innovation and entrepreneurship, what would be the need that we should address and what should be done to be realized through entrepreneurs individually or collectively? And how do we answer our manufacturing infrastructure, which, say, in India is largely in the small and medium enterprises? The micro, small, and medium enterprises are responsible for contributing to the manufacturing share in our GDP. And it is a source of employment to our people. It's a source of contributing to our exports. But we see that our MSME, that's the acronym, 30% of our MSMEs are working in the service sector and 6% are working in the manufacturing sector. Any country which aspires to generate wealth will have to first look at manufacturing more than the services in their life cycle of evolution. So we would like to hear some thoughts from students and experts alike on what should be our focus on translational research and on entrepreneurship that we must address in detail tomorrow, and what has not been reflected in the summary sessions, because we heard fewer people and many in the audience are unheard of. So we throw the issue open on what co-generation of solutions are on your mind, which we can do individually or collectively. How do we bring value to small and medium enterprises. I'm open to anyone who wishes to take the floor.
I happen to be part of the BRICS Academic Forum, in which I had written the India MSME paper. And also I happen to be part of a larger study, which is based in the University of Manchester, and we're essentially focusing on what you're calling as rising powers. In fact, India, China, and Brazil, these are the three countries represented, and focusing on how the local enterprises are sort of interfacing with the global markets and interfacing with the global buyers. And within that, one major issue which comes up is that of standards, and which is both product and process standards. I think a larger concern relates to the process standards, actually, which sort of includes the way products are made, and sort of it also includes issues in health, issues in environment, ethical issues. So there needs to be some kind of a common understanding about the BRICS countries as to how we address particular issues in informality, which impinges on the standards issue. And the second thing is, we are also wondering that being part of a global economy for quite some time now, let's say at least more about a quarter of a century for all the countries, are we in a position to have we become only the standard takers, or have we become only working for the global buyers who are based in the OECD countries or in the global north, if you like? Or we have been actually able to influence standards or sort of create our own standards in both, particularly in product and process in both the cases. So if we reflect on that, and what are the ways by which the BRICS countries can come together, maybe sort of think in terms of a common certification process, for instance, kind of a common standard which should be placed much higher, but also would be one way to address the MSME. That's one way the MSMEs and the institutions concerning MSMEs and these in these countries can actually cooperate. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Can I just highlight the question you have asked for BRICS country? It's also valid for United Kingdom and other countries in Europe and America. So this issue is not unknown to other countries, and they are equally trying to solve it. One of the things we need to think about parallelly, one is to actually attract and build more efficient, successful small companies. But at the same time, what we should be looking at, how do we encourage them, support them, create an environment where a small company can become a middle company, mid-sized company? They scale up from small to bigger size companies, and then they become bigger over time. And this is where I think there is an opportunity to utilize public procurement, which these large countries have, to scale up small companies, to make them bigger. That's my point. And I would encourage us to debate that, role of public procurement to, in a way, create new companies, bigger companies. Number two, while we are doing this, I think it is discussed here already, it is important we look after biological impact of technology in terms of ergonomics, in terms of health and safety of people. And I see that there is a significant lack of health and safety culture in corporate world in BRICS countries, and then forget about the small companies. And I think it is really important, while we are trying to improve our small companies, make them bigger, we also make it in a safe and healthy manner. And there are people who are looking at those aspects. They should be, they could probably contribute in setting standards. But more important problem in these countries, I would imagine, is implementation. Because there are lots of laws, there are lots of rules, it's just people doesn't follow. How do you implement good practice? I think it's important to think about.
I have a few points which I just wanted to make. When you talk about science, technology, and innovation and entrepreneurship, a thing which we should always keep in mind that it flourishes in rich ecosystems. And when we're talking about the BRICS countries, I think one of the things we should consider is how we can extend our ecosystems and create a larger shared ecosystem which our entrepreneurs and our innovators can leverage. For example, just now I know that one of our startups is actually getting some things prototyped in China right now, you know, and the kind of prototyping facilities that certain cities in China have created are unprecedented. I mean, it's remarkable what they have. So I think it makes sense to leverage strengths in different countries. Now, that's just an example. There are different parts of the ecosystem. For example, there are customers on one side, there are suppliers on the other side, there are people who are contributing know-how, contributing employees, and so on and so forth. The idea should be to leverage whatever is best in whichever ecosystem that you can use. And to make that happen, actually what you need are easy mechanisms to reach out, get information, to create agreements which one can easily work with. Currently, the barriers which exist should be removed to be able to leverage each other's ecosystem. The second point I want to make is that all of us, all these countries are growing towards, are a path of rapid growth. And we are all trying to develop our own economies. And of course, a common problem all of us face is energy and environment. And that is a common thread that we can easily leverage, in my opinion. We should be definitely working and looking at mechanisms where we can draw upon each other's strengths in the energy and environment space. We have shared problems. The problem of Beijing is also the problem of Delhi, right? Clearly, there's a great need to address some of these in a common way and to leverage learnings from each place. The last point I want to make is that I think while we can emphasize academia and so on, I think it's the entrepreneurs who will be the fastest and the quickest people to spot opportunities and to draw upon it. They will be the people who will bring the energy to the table. They will be the people who will be resourceful to draw upon whatever strengths they can find wherever. That, I think, should be our focus in terms of how do we, if we believe that entrepreneurs are the right vehicle to deliver innovation in a scalable and sustainable way, then it is those entrepreneurs that we should be drawing upon to draw upon, the strengths in different places. So I think we need to build a story around entrepreneurs, not as much around academia. When we are thinking about some of these issues. Thank you.
Yeah. So I would like to make few points, particularly from MSME point of view. One of the thing while working with MSME, we found that there are three levels of gaps in MSME. One is they're lagging on innovation side, they're lagging on market links, and they're lagging on operational excellence. So I think if we could create some platform where local institutes and MSMEs can talk to each other for solving local needs, and how it is done in other countries, it could be learning for each other. The other thing I felt is there should be a repository of problems from MSMEs. Because many of these MSMEs, they work in isolation and everybody tries to solve the same problem. Now it is in the country also and intra countries also. So if BRICS Forum can create a pool of problems, probably it will be something where people can use these common solutions which are available. And academia will also pick choose some problems depending on their resources and skill sets. The other point I would like to also mention is, some of the best practices, if some sector is doing in some country, it should be highlighted. Probably those best practices can be easily adapted by, the other countries, which is not normally available. I have some example of, in Mexico, how informal sector is consulted by some pool of consultants. So that case study is available, but such case studies from China, from Brazil can be very useful, or from India. Then one of the other things which I feel is more on operational level, where these MSMEs, they lack considerably on management training. Okay, so somehow our management institutes are, very seldom focused on with small businesses. So how we can have such management training? And other angle for MSME, which we felt very strongly while working with them, is cash flow management. This may be a very simple thing, but the entrepreneur is keep on playing his game. It's like his addiction to doing entrepreneurship. But somehow this basics of such thing, if we can introduce by some forum and share with each other, what is happening in other places, will be useful. Thank you.
Could I request Mr. D.R. Mehta to give his thinking about how BRICS, you have a very vast experience and also the global level networking for leveraging, how the BRICS countries could take advantage of STIE?
Thank you. I think one of the points I could mention straight away, and which I talked about yesterday, is how to take innovation forward and make it a part of social entrepreneurship. And the example that we have set up in Tata Trust of creating a foundation for innovation and social entrepreneurship, because as trusts, we could not invest in equity in the small companies or the social entrepreneurship ventures. So I think that would be something which could be thought about across the BRICS countries and see whether this is a viable solution to address some of the problems of taking innovation forward and making it a part of social entrepreneurship. Besides this, of course, I would not like to just make a guess at this time. What I feel is that there is need for good networking on good practices, standard, best practices rather, not good, and cultivate an approach of excellence. I think this is something which often gets neglected when we have small companies coming up through this social entrepreneurship. And if it is not built up initially in their DNA, in their culture, it can create a lot of problems at a later stage. I think I would leave it at that. Thank you very much.
4:30 preferably. Till that time, please.
Unfortunately, I'm not below 30, but since I'm still a student, I like to put forward this. I had an opportunity to participate in two of the events which was mentioned in this forum, which one was e-waste hackathon, another was Medha. And both of these had something which was very unique, which was on-site visit to identify the problems. And second, it brought people from different groups together. In the teams, we had doctors. In Medha, we had teams from doctors, management people. Then we had different mentors who were domain experts, then business experts. So in small time, as a participant, what we experienced was a very rich set of ideas flowing. And secondly, we wouldn't have met these people and we wouldn't have thought of these set of lines of thought. So I'm curious if such event can be extended to, say, this inclusive manufacturing problems, like one in MSME, the problems faced by MSME or the agricultural sector or rural sectors. So this is something I would look forward to, and this is my kind suggestion.
So I think one of the issues that we talked about yesterday is, and I think it's going to be relevant also to certainly all the BRICS countries, if one is talking about science, technology, innovation, the question is how to make sure that the products of, or the outcomes of science, technology, innovation are able to positively impact as many people as possible in our own countries. And I think obviously, as soon as you're talking about large scale impact, the role of policy becomes very, very important. So I think we talked a little bit about the role of policy in areas such as inclusive manufacturing, but I think obviously science, technology, innovation policy has very broad implications in a lot of different areas. And I think one area where I feel there may be a significant value addition among the BRICS countries is really to be both, in a sense, exchanging their own experiences with innovation policy, because I know each of the BRICS countries has been taking, I mean, I don't know that much about South Africa, but certainly Brazil, India, and China have been taking very, very different approaches to thinking about innovation. We've all had successes in different areas. China's had a lot of successes in, you know, you started with manufacturing, you've moved into electronics and all of that, automobiles, renewables. Brazil's done very, very well in pharmaceuticals and biotech and aerospace. India's had its own successes in pharmaceuticals and other areas, certainly space and so on, and other areas. And I think our innovation policies have actually been still rather different. So I think there may be certainly value addition in thinking about how we might learn from each other, but also then start thinking about maybe some ways of synergizing in certain ways in thinking about innovation policy in areas of common interest. And I think that was a point made earlier, that many of these countries may have common challenges and common interests, and therefore in those particular areas, maybe doing a little bit of synergy or thinking about how to build some commonalities in innovation policy, I think might be useful, because in the end, that has the potential to lead to really large scale impact. So just a thought.
Well, can I request Madeline from Nesta to reflect on the basis on which the Global Challenge Research Fund was created, and what kind of experiences you would like to counsel us on before we take this path?
Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak and share reflections. And I was actually hoping to talk a bit about challenge-focused innovation policy in any case. So I think the idea of centering innovation policy around challenges, or talking about, say, mission-driven innovation policy, is becoming more common in a number of different countries. And I think the Global Challenges Research Fund is an interesting example of that. It's one of the earlier experiments in challenge-focused innovation policy in the UK, which before that primarily distributed academic funding on an excellence basis, so to any sector where excellent research was to be found. This is an early experiment in directing it towards areas of particular public benefit. I think the challenge... my one reflection, which might be relevant for the translational research call that you're putting together, is that there are different approaches to putting together a challenge focus in a call or in a policy. And I think GCRF takes a very broad approach to what it defines as to be challenges. So I think it had 15 or so areas of focus. They're very, very broad. So in one sense, most research projects could probably fit into one of those areas. And I think there's some value in having that type of focus, but I also think you might want to consider narrowing down some of your challenges to be much more specific. And one area I thought might be worth picking up on, following from what Professor Rajkumar Roy said, one area we've been looking at in Nesta is around how you can bring forward innovation to solve quite specific problems. And one particular mechanism that's been used is around pre-commercial procurement and the involvement of public sector commissioners and procurers in defining the specific problems that they want solved, often by MSMEs. And then being able to set up some types of mechanisms that can involve essentially commitments to purchase those innovations once they've been developed. So in the UK we have something called the Small Business Research Initiative, which gives public sector commissioners a chance to say what problems they want solved, invite SMEs to propose solutions, and then the best solutions have some commitment to actually be funded. So that gives an opportunity for adoption and diffusion of the innovations which might not otherwise happen. And I know that procurement rules and laws differ very much in different countries. I've been recently speaking to some partners in Brazil, in Sao Paulo, about whether this type of model is possible there, and it's much more difficult for various reasons. But to the extent to which you can be a little bit, you can consider more specific challenges as part of your translational research call, and then work out how policymakers can support those initiatives to come forward and be adopted and scaled, might be worth thinking about.
Can we invite some youngsters or those who have not been on this table? I wanted to hear them more.
Add one more point. Like I think earlier we have discussed about, like, we need more collaboration on the problems which are common to all these countries. But one thing which we also need to look into is how to sustain these type of collaborations. So, like, all of these countries, we are democratic countries, and our leadership is subject to change over a period of time. But our economic and socio-economic interests, if we can focus upon the converging socio-economic interests and involve youngsters and people as a part of this, then it can be sustained for a longer time. For example, I will just give an example. For example, like air and water pollution, and even energy, green energy, is a problem which all the developing countries are facing in the present scenario. So why can't we form hubs or like platforms for interaction of people, the engineers, the experts, the students, where they can collaborate and that collaboration can go for a long time in a sustainable manner with little or like even if there is not a proper support from the leadership, but still, because these interests are of common nature, the civilians, the engineers, and the experts, they will keep interacting and sharing their experiences so that solutions can be achieved. Solutions can be, technological solutions can be developed over a period of time through this type of sustained interactions. So that's my point.
Just like we did the Young Forum, which was good, and it is going to be continued. The next is going to be in China, and then it will travel to other countries. Can we bring the best entrepreneurs from BRICS, especially from micro and small industries, maybe 10 from each country? They share their experiences, they live together, they talk face to face, they share the practices, and if we find it is successful, then I think it can grow to other countries. Just a thought for your mind to consider, and then tomorrow maybe we can discuss further on that.
I think very interesting points have come up. I would only like to add that I think what Professor Baldev Raj has mentioned just now and a few other suggestions, I think we should be able to develop them into very concrete action points with timelines and with deliverables. And the other point which I can appreciate is that try to develop mechanism of interfacing with funding agencies, interfacing with other agencies that will take the product or the. I think it was a very interesting suggestion that we develop some kind of interfacing with somebody who will finally take the product. But of course, the question is that you need, let us say, a number of participants who will participate in that, and only one of them is winning. So what will motivate the other nine to invest, knowing that they have only 1 in 10 chance of getting it back? So I think we need a support mechanism that at least what they invest to create that prototype or to create that candidate prototype is not lost. Otherwise, it is like buying lottery tickets, only one wins. So I think these two mechanisms, if we can incorporate, one is of interfacing with various funding agencies so that we have the one link in the ecosystem built in. The other one is a kind of a support mechanism so that it incentivizes all qualified or competent entrepreneurs to put in their money, put in their resources, knowing well that they will recover it even if they don't win it. Thank you.
He talked about sustainability and scaling up. Being in this forum for science and technology, and we were talking about innovations also. We do innovations, and as professors have shown that whatever technology has been developed, and then whether we have taken care of the future. Similarly, if these innovations are coming, and I will talk about Indian context, that when the plastic came, it was very, very, it was felt it is very useful, and it was a revolution, and then now we find that there are the problems. So similarly, when we innovate and when we go for the application, and then it may become very popular also, similarly like electronics and mobiles also, but there are certain fronts where we have to work to see that sustainability of the ecosystem, and that has to be taken in parallel. Then I think we will be able to go for very long. Otherwise, the things will be, we will be doing the innovations, things will be coming, revolutions will be coming. It will be having side effects on the ecosystem, and then ecosystem may not be sustainable. So that area is there where we have to look into. Thank you.
You just made the point. I also wanted to make it clear that there's a huge unmet demands in all the BRIC partner countries. And one of the biggest bottlenecks that could hinder the growth and success of our whole partnership could be a negative response to the entire sustainability chain. So we have to first meet the demands of the unprivileged people, and just not focus on consumerism. Like there should not be focus on creating new needs. Creating new needs means like making new products, which is not part of our life cycle. So there is already a huge unmet need, and all the BRIC partner countries would share it, that those needs are quite challenging. So the partner should work together to scale up these success stories, and sustainability, especially the environmental sustainability, should be part of the entire life cycle chain, the entire life cycle chain of the products or services. Thank you.
Yes, Professor Satish.
I'm hungry. So what I propose in this end of the meeting is, can we come up with a simple questionnaire that every project proposal should fill out, which will indicate as to what they're developing is a sustainable product or not. It may not be a sustainable product to begin with, but at least it will put into their minds that they need to work towards sustainability. And I think if for each proposal, each product that is developed, if this simple questionnaire that is filled out, we can come out with that questionnaire, then I think we'll be taking a step in the right direction.
I think our talk would not end here. It's just that we triggered a thought, but we would certainly come out with an open opportunities and some robust criteria which will be transparently disseminated. And our timeline is that if we could come up with some opportunity to be to be prepared as a scoping, and we could take it to the BRICS STI funding parties meeting, which is happening in end of May in South Africa, and we would follow it up at our ministerial meeting and the BRICS Young Scientist Conclave in July. Towards the last week of July, we are going to have the ministerial meeting and the Young Scientist Conclave and the senior official meeting. So we wish to see how collectively our counterpart partners from the other BRICS countries could give momentum, and we could come up with some blueprint in public domain after July. With those timelines, even if you have some thoughts for us, our profiles are with you, our emails are there. This few hours or minutes are not enough for us. Please, we'll be open to receiving your thoughts, because our timeline up to July end will make a difference to our purposeful action. Thank you indeed for joining us. Over to Bhujang Rao sir.
I think I must thank all the participants who have come here, who participated in the BRICS meeting, and they have given a lot of good suggestions. And as Dr. Relia said, this is going to be a preliminary meeting. Actual meeting is tomorrow. So I think you have formed a kind of basis, and we can probably think overnight with many good other ideas, come back for tomorrow meeting. Okay, thank you very much.